Into the void. When Shannon and I returned to the States from Australia, I felt not only like I had finished the farewell tour, but also that I wanted to bid farewell to KISS for good. I was feeling much the same as I did in 1982, completely disenchanted. The idea of working with them again became less appealing to me as the days went by. Within weeks of returning, my publicist notified me that I was being inducted into the Bronx Walk of Fame. It was a prestigious honor, and I became very excited about it. The ceremony would take place on the Grand Concourse, in front of the Bronx Courthouse, just a few blocks from Yankee Stadium. A plaque with my name on it would be placed atop a lamp post, about 20 feet from the street. I was being inducted with several other celebrities, including Academy Award, nominated director Stanley Kubrick, actor Burt Young, retired New York Mets player Ed Cranepool, actress Diane Carroll, and U.S. Secretary of State Colin Powell. Following the afternoon ceremony, there was a black tie affair in the evening, during which each of the honorees got up and said a few words to the audience. I enjoyed the whole event, and I had fun meeting such an impressive and diverse group of VIPs. Shannon and I continued to enjoy our break from touring, but I slowly began to realize that she wanted different things out of life, and I couldn't give them to her. She wanted to get pregnant and raise a family. I'd already been down that road and was more interested in focusing on my career and traveling. So we decided to call it quits that year, and she moved back to Canada. Shannon eventually got married and had a couple of kids, but we've remained friends over the years. After Shannon left, I reconnected with my old girlfriend, Ronnie. I was seeing her at the time my father passed away in 2000, and she really helped me get through a rough period in my life. I still remember the morning I got the call from my brother, Charlie. I knew my dad wasn't doing well after his stroke, but I'd been so busy working in L.A. with KISS, I was unaware of just how much he had deteriorated. The night before I received the call, Ronnie and I had been up late entertaining some friends. Normally it would have taken me at least 30 minutes to crawl out of bed after a party, but the day my dad passed away was very different. I remember jumping up in bed early that morning as if someone had shaken me. Even stranger was the fact that I remember being wide awake at the time. I also remember feeling a strange presence in the bedroom, like a cool breeze entering through the door and slowly moving past my bed and finally exiting out the window. At the time I had no inkling that anything had happened to my dad, but when my brother told me exactly what time he had passed away, I did a little math in my head and realized it was around the same time I had been awakened so abruptly. I remember my mom telling me some family secrets about paranormal experiences, and I always believed that I had the ability to communicate with the other side. Upon getting the news, I booked a flight back to New York and helped with some of the funeral arrangements, although my brother and sister handled most of that. I was on a very tight schedule since a KISS tour was about to commence, and the band needed me back out west. Most of it really went by in a blur, but I remember Jimmy Genter being there for me the whole time, driving me around and giving me a shoulder to lean on. The scene at the cemetery was surreal. Fans were outside the mausoleum where my dad was being laid to rest. All I wanted to do was pay my respects to my father's memory and be there for my mom and family, but the crowd outside the service made it hard for me to relax and stay focused. After the service was over, Jimmy quickly cleared a path through the onlookers and whisked me away in a limo to Westchester Airport. When we arrived, a private jet had its engines running. Jimmy gave me a hug and I was gone. 5 hours later I landed in California and began filming a Pepsi commercial that seemed to go on forever. The tour began the following day. I never really did get a chance to mourn the death of my father. After I was back in Westchester, Ronnie arrived with a dozen suitcases and moved into my place without any reservations. Things started off fine, but as the weeks progressed it became apparent to both of us that we had lost something over time and weren't going to recapture it. One night we had a big fight, and she started punching me. I really wasn't in the mood for any nonsense that night, and I've certainly never believed in hitting a woman. So I called my bodyguard Mac and asked him to deal with her. He took her away to his place on my request and things got a little sticky after that. Mac wasn't in the mood for any nonsense, either, that night and decided to let the cops deal with her. That wasn't the best way to handle the problem, but he told me she had become too violent for even him. The cops came and decided to drop her off at the psych ward. I'm not exactly sure what crazy story she told the doctor and local authorities, but they were planning to arrest me pending an investigation of the facts. I had no idea of their plans, but God bless Jimmy Genter. When Jimmy and my buddy Mike found out the police were planning to raid my place, they quickly intervened and explained that her accusations were not credible. Now, in most cases that wouldn't have changed anything, but Jimmy and Mike were both federal marshals and very well respected by their fellow officers and peers. They explained that they knew me personally, and that I had entertained both of them in my home. After a few tense moments on both sides, the police decided to take their advice and call off the raid. After I regained my composure, I decided to try to help her. We made a deal with her doctor at the hospital. He said if I secured a rehab that was willing to accept her as a patient, they would release her in my custody. I made some calls, wrote a check, and got her into a facility. I called Mac and asked him to pick her up at the hospital and escort her on the plane, and deliver her to the rehab. He did as instructed, and she's doing much better today. As I wrote this story, I tried to imagine how my life would have turned out if I hadn't met Jimmy back in 1983. It's something I can't even begin to visualize. But he's not the only one who has been there for me. There was another guy who ended up saving my ass on more than one occasion. Chris McNamara, the aforementioned Mac, used to date my sister-in-law, Anita. When I found out he was a bouncer and bodyguard, I didn't wait long before inviting him to work for me in a similar capacity. I brought him out on the road to watch my back when I was touring with Kiss. We've had some close calls over the years, and this story is about one of them. One night on tour, we had a day off, and I felt like going out and shooting pool, so Mac found a place right up our alley. It had dozens of pool tables, arcade games, a mechanical bull, a bar and restaurant, and a strip club all under the same roof. I remember telling Mac, if we had places like this back east, they'd be packed all the time. We had a few beers and played several games of pool. Later on, a couple of buddies joined us. We grabbed a quick bite to eat and then thought it might be fun to check out the strippers at the other end of the club. I normally wasn't a big fan of strip clubs. I never liked the idea of being in a situation where if I got excited, I couldn't do anything about it. I always found that frustrating. Well, as the evening progressed, I ordered champagne for everyone, and we started getting very silly and loud with the girls. It was beginning to get late, so Mac wisely suggested it might be a good idea to head back to the hotel. Within the last 10 minutes of our stay, I bumped into an old girlfriend, Audrey, and decided to invite her back to my room. I had a limousine waiting for us in the parking lot, and as we were leaving I ran into the bathroom for a minute while everyone went outside. When I walked out, Audrey looked upset. "What happened?" I asked. She pointed to a tall guy leaning against the wall and explained that he had said something nasty to her. I immediately walked over and confronted the guy. I asked him what he had said. As soon as he started talking, I gave him a solid shot to the head, and he went down for the count. What I hadn't noticed, unfortunately, was that he wasn't alone. The guy had several buddies with him, and the biggest one was marching straight toward me. Mac, though, saw what was happening. He quickly intercepted the approaching guy and gave him a hard right hand to the chin. Crack. Everyone in the parking lot heard the sound of the poor guy's jaw breaking. The rest of his friends stopped cold in their tracks. Max scared them off just long enough for us to jump into the limo. In the process, though, a security guard in the parking lot sprayed Mac with pepper spray, and he was temporarily blinded by it. We slammed the door shut and I yelled to the limo driver, "Let's get the fuck out of here." When we got into the street, we headed for the on-ramp to the expressway, but at the end of the street our path was blocked by a black BMW and a black Mercedes. The limo driver seemed reluctant to go forward, but I quickly threw $200 bills in his lap.
"Hit it,"
I shouted. "Go up on the fucking sidewalk around them, or we're dead." The driver acted on impulse and did exactly what I told him to do. We narrowly made it past the two cars and shot up the entrance ramp onto the highway. I turned around and saw the two black cars spin out and follow us up the ramp in hot pursuit. I looked around the limo. Everyone seemed okay except for Mac, who said he could barely see. I told the limo driver to floor it, and not to stop for anything. Then I called 911 and told them we were being chased by two cars with guns. I gave them our location on the highway and waited patiently. The two cars were approaching and things were getting tense in the limousine. I wasn't sure if they really had guns, and I didn't want to find out, either. A few seconds went by. Then, miraculously, a police car flew up the on-ramp in front of us with its lights flashing, quickly followed by a second police car. I looked through the rear window and saw the Mercedes and BMW slow down and pull U-turns. I told the limo driver to pull over immediately. I wanted to go explain to the cops what had happened at the bar, and thank them for saving our asses. When I explained who I was and what had happened, the officers were quite sympathetic. They even escorted us to the hotel just to be safe, a gesture I really appreciated. By the time we got back, Mac's vision was clearing up, and he did a quick inspection of the limo. He said he had thought he had heard a few shots during all the craziness. But I wasn't so sure, I hadn't heard anything. Upon closer inspection, though, we discovered two bullet holes, one on the side fender and one in the radiator, which was now beginning to emit some steam. I looked at Mac and began to laugh. "Shit. That was a close one." One day in November 2007 I came home and found a message on my voicemail. To my surprise, it was Gene Simmons extending an invitation to be on his television show. He went on to say that he was going to be roasted on the show, and that he wanted me to be part of it. It was going to be a very big deal, he promised, with Cher and Steven Tyler among the list of celebrities who were going to take part. I listened to the message a few times, and with each playback I became more convinced that I could sense a slight tone of desperation in his voice. I thought to myself, "Gene, desperate? Probably not." But I decided to do a little research and find out exactly what was going on with the show. His producer sent me several emails requesting an answer, but I didn't want to reply right away. I thought about some of the roasts I'd seen in the past, and remembered being invited to Hugh Hefner's roast, at which I sat on the dais between Patty Hearst and Deborah Harry. I ended up losing my temper at a party following that event. I'd been chatting with Hugh and his entourage of playmates when out of the corner of my eye I saw some guy pouring a bottle of champagne over my daughter's head. I dropped everything and darted over to Monique. I grabbed the guy and started punching him in the face. I only got 3 or 4 shots in before the bouncers intervened. Having seen the whole incident, they just pulled the guy out of my hands and dragged the half-conscious asshole out of the club. They apologized to me for the incident, but I was far more interested in my daughter. Luckily, Monique was okay, she was just a little shaken up. Most of the roasts I recalled consisted of people who were lifelong friends or co-workers of the person being honored. That's when it suddenly hit me, Gene doesn't have any friends. Never did as far back as I can remember. And everyone who has ever worked with Gene in the past has either been fired or quit. The only person who's remained with him over the years is Paul Stanley. At that point I decided to give Paul a call and see if he was going to be involved with the show. We shot the shit briefly, and then I hit him with the question. There was a slight pause as Paul carefully considered his response. I'm not doing the show, Ace. It's not in my comfort zone. I didn't press him on the matter. We chatted for a few more minutes, wished each other well, and said good, bye. The next few days I continued making calls in an attempt to find out who else was going to be involved. Peter said he'd received an invitation from Jean, but I told him I was busy. It didn't occur to me to call Eric Singer or Tommy Thayer, since they were just hired guns wearing our makeup. After a few more calls to some of the other people who were supposed to be involved, I decided it was probably better if I just bowed out gracefully. When I finally replied to Gene's producer, declining the invitation, he seemed somewhat agitated. I figured he was getting frustrated with the whole idea of a Gene Simmons roast, since most of the people I had contacted had no intention of taking part. I wasn't going to let it bother me, though. I decided to put the whole thing out of my mind and concentrate on recording. Several months passed. I had forgotten about the roast until a friend called and said the program had already aired. How was it? I asked, not really caring about the answer. My friend laughed. Pretty bad. He went on to explain that most of the guests involved appeared to be comedians paid by the network to appear on the show. For a moment I almost felt bad for Gene. I mean, really? How embarrassing. It's been documented in more than a few publications that I've had some alien encounters and sightings in my life. One of my homes is located in the Lower Hudson Valley, a well-known UFO hotspot where thousands of verified sightings have taken place over the years. I've seen some very strange stuff at times, sober and under the influence. Most of the people in the area just kind of take it for granted, and I, for one, am not fazed by it in the least. My most memorable encounter happened in 2002. At first I thought the whole experience was a dream. What changed my mind was what happened afterward. I woke up one morning and found myself lying on the ground in the front doorway of my home, my body half in the house and half in the driveway. I'd woken up in a lot of strange places in my life, but this took the cake. I slowly got up and went inside for a cup of coffee. As my head cleared, I could recall a strange dream about being inside a spaceship. It didn't seem that weird, since I dreamt about UFOs and aliens from time to time in the past, without ever giving it a second thought. This time, though, seemed different, more real. Maybe because I'd never woken up in the doorway before. The more I thought about the dream, the more vivid it became in my mind's eye. After breakfast, I decided to go outside and look around the yard. I stumbled upon a circular impression in the grass, almost like a giant burn. It appeared to be about 30 feet in diameter, but after inspecting it more closely with a tape measure, it actually turned out to be 27 feet. 27. My lucky number. Later, in the shower, I checked my body for marks, some sign of having been abducted. But there was nothing strange to be found. By the next day, the impression in the grass had disappeared, and I just went about my business like nothing had ever happened. I figured if what I had dreamt really had taken place, there wasn't much I could do about it. Close encounters, real, imagined, or manufactured, had long been a part of my life. Sometimes they were merely a source of amusement, like the time I was on a hunting trip with my buddies Frank and Bob. It all started with an invitation from Frank, whose family owned about 70 acres of land in upstate New York. Hanging out there was my first real experience with hunting and handguns. Frank was a very good marksman, and later on in life he became a licensed federal firearms dealer. He was the guy, with the help of his older brother Kenny, who taught me how to shoot. Since the 70s I've had a love affair with guns, and I shoot just about every chance I get, which isn't really that often, due to my hectic schedule. This particular incident occurred on probably my second or third visit to Frank's place. All three of us, at the time, enjoyed our drugs and alcohol, and we weren't exactly amateurs at it. It was the last day of a long weekend trip. We had used up all of our ammunition and blown up a few other things on Frank's property, and now we were looking for something different to do. I remembered that I had a few weather balloons in my trunk, and the whole crazy charade began from there. We had been drinking all day, and Frank and I decided it might be fun to dress Bob as an alien, and see how authentic he would look. Since we didn't have any silver space suits, green makeup, or ray guns, we decided to improvise. We just grabbed some ordinary household items, a white sheet, a cork, and a flashlight. And the weather balloon. One of my favorite science fiction films is Invaders from Mars. Most of the film lacks authenticity in terms of special effects, but I always loved the appearance of one particular character, an alien leader encased in a glass sphere. If you've ever seen the movie, you'll remember. Remember that the alien had a large forehead and brain, characteristics we hope to replicate with Bob. To get the desired effect, we stretched the weather balloon over Bob's head, which was no small task. At first he had it around his neck and none of his features were visible. He looked so ridiculous that Frank and I completely lost it. We laughed so hard that I actually threw up. When we finally regained our composure, we helped Bob reposition the balloon just above his eyes. At first there was too much air in the balloon, but after letting some out, he began to look the part of an alien, totally fucking weird. To finish off his costume, we wrapped him in the sheet, burned the cork and rubbed it around his eyes, and handed him a flashlight. We helped Bob get through the cabin door, which was harder than you might think, since we had to squeeze the balloon and direct him without popping it. Then things got really interesting. We led Bob down the hill and told him to walk along the side of the road, but not too close. Maybe 10 yards or so. While he was slowly walking, he put the flashlight inside the sheet and under his chin. From a distance, in the dark, he looked like, well, something not of this earth. Soon enough a car went by. Frank and I were hiding in the bushes. The car slowed down momentarily as it passed Bob, then sped away. This happened a few more times with similar results. Eventually an 18-wheeler came along, and when the driver spotted Bob on the side of the road, he slammed on his brakes and almost jackknifed the truck. That was a little more than we had bargained for. We'd better get him inside before somebody takes a shot at him, Frank said. A few minutes later we were approached by a pickup truck, one that had already passed by earlier. There were two guys in the cab and a shotgun rack in the bed. Clearly these guys wanted a second look. Maybe they were out to do a little alien hunting. Turn off the flashlight, I yelled to Bob. The road suddenly went dark and we all hid quietly until the pickup truck drove off. Then we whisked Bob back into the cabin and called it a night. A few days later the local newspaper ran a story bearing the following headline, "Local man has alien sighting outside Port Jervis." We couldn't help but laugh about the whole experience. Apparently Bob had been even more convincing than we'd realized. Once I got my studio up and running, I continued writing and recording new material. In mid-2007 I once again hooked up with Anton Fig, along with a new bassist, Anthony Esposito. The first track we worked on was Pain in the Neck, and within a few short months the songs really came together. In October, Ed Trunk called and asked if I wanted to perform at a Halloween party he was hosting at the Hard Rock Cafe in New York. I talked it over with Anthony and he agreed to help me assemble a band for the performance. I hired Scott Coogan on drums and Derek Hawkins on guitar to round off the new lineup. I told Ed I'd love to do it, but in reality I was a little apprehensive. This would be my first live performance in more than 5 years with my own band. And I'd been sober only a year, following a relapse in Las Vegas. But all my fears were put to rest that night at the Hard Rock. I hit the stage with a powerful set and the show turned out to be a big success. Anton Figg sat in on drums for a song, to the delight of the fan, and reviews reported that I looked and sounded better than ever. When I got home that night, I was happy and thankful for the outcome, which seemed all the more remarkable considering what a struggle I'd gone through just 18 months earlier. The difficulty had begun one night in early February 2006, when my sister, Nancy, called to say that my mom was very sick. She was in a nursing home in Saginaw, Michigan, where my sister lived with her husband, Ron. From the sound of Nancy's voice, I knew the situation was serious, so I decided to jump on a plane the following day. Complicating matters was the fact that it was Super Bowl weekend and the game was being played in Detroit. Most of the flights were booked solid, but I managed to get a ticket and fly into Detroit that Friday afternoon. On the plane, before we landed, the pilot mentioned that a snowstorm was moving into the area, and I became concerned. I thought my plan might be in jeopardy. After we landed, though, I succeeded in renting a car and got on I-75 headed towards Saginaw. Normally this is about a 2-hour drive, maybe less. But the snow had already begun to fall, and shortly after we got on the road, the weather took a dramatic turn for the worse. There were some tense moments on the highway, but I finally arrived at my destination several hours late, but in one piece, thank God. I got a chance to see my mom briefly that night, and my worst fears were realized. She was close to death. The doctor said she probably wouldn't last through the weekend. I was overwhelmed with grief, but also very thankful that I had a chance to say goodbye to my mom. I spent the weekend at the nursing home, and had to return to New York on Sunday. Before leaving, I told my mom it was all right for her to join Dad up in heaven, and that he was waiting for her. I was holding her hand at the time, and even though she couldn't talk, she squeezed my hand and appeared to understand what I was saying. I kissed her goodbye and told her I loved her, and then drove back to Detroit for my flight home. I later heard from my sister that she passed away just hours after I left. A few weeks after my mother's death, I got the news that KISS was being honored by VH1 as part of the network's first Rock Honors Award show in Las Vegas. I wasn't sure what role I would play in the ceremony, since Tommy Thayer had been wearing my makeup and costume and performing with KISS. I remember Ed Trunk calling me up and saying, angrily, "I can't fucking believe those guys. That's your award. You were a co-founder of the band, and you designed the spaceman makeup and costume." I wasn't sure what to think. As I told Ed, "Well, I guess I'll be getting a call from Paul or Gene." The phone never rang, so Ed came up with the idea for me to play with an all-star band that was also performing on the show. At the time I was a little reluctant to even go to Las Vegas for the taping without a formal invitation from KISS, but Ed convinced me. "You have to go, Ace. Don't let them get away with it. They're always trying to make it seem like you never existed. Fuck 'em." So I agreed and booked a flight to L.A. and started rehearsals with Slash, Gilby Clark, Scott Ian, and Tommy Lee. We rehearsed a couple of days and then jumped on a private jet and were flown to Las Vegas by VH1. There was a lot of excitement revolving around the show. In addition to KISS, Def Leppard, Judas Priest, and Queen were being honored. When I arrived on the set, I realized that it was a much bigger deal than I had anticipated. As usual, Ed Trunk had given me the right advice. I was still wondering why I never got a call from Paul or Gene concerning the show, but I really didn't want to think about it. I just pretended that everything was fine. When I saw the guys from KISS, I greeted them like nothing had ever happened, posed with them for a few pictures, and acted like we were long, lost friends. The truth, though, is that I started feeling ill about the whole production and how my contribution to KISS was again being minimized. I'd been sober for some time, but before the show I started feeling even more anxious, and when Slash offered me a drink backstage, I just couldn't say no. I didn't want to feel my emotions anymore and was still very upset about my mother's passing. Rob Zombie joined us on lead vocals, and together we performed a kick-ass version of God of Thunder. Right before the show, I suggested to Slash we throw in the riff from Led Zeppelin's Bring It On Home between our guitar solos, and he agreed. It blew my mind that we pulled it off flawlessly, in harmony, without any prior rehearsal. That was a rush. The show progressed, eventually Kiss played a few songs. I wondered if they felt strange during their performance, knowing I was watching their every move. We all posed together at the end of the show for the press, and then it was over. I went back to my hotel suite knowing I had lost my sobriety, and even though I wanted to blame Kiss or my mom's passing away, I knew deep in my soul it was my own fault. Later I heard from Slash, who apologized for handing me my first drink. He was feeling somewhat guilty, since he had also struggled with addiction, but I assured him that I was planning on getting fucked up anyway, and if it hadn't been him, it would have been someone else. I stayed in Vegas a few more days and continued to party, and then headed back to New York. I should have called some of my sober buddies and told them what happened, but I didn't want to face the music. I continued drinking and self-medicating and slowly began spinning out of control. By the end of the summer I was a mess. If not for my daughter Monique's intervention, I'm not sure what would have happened. One day Monique called and expressed concern for my well-being. She had been told I was getting fucked up, and she was well aware of my destructive behavior. Monique had also been in the same place herself, and she realized I was going down a road from which I might not return. She started crying, and somehow got through to me. When I got off the phone with her, I looked in the mirror and said, "Well, now what?" I knew I was at a point where I hadn't gone over the edge with what I was taking, but I was very, very close. I had only been drinking and doing pills, but I was seriously thinking about getting some coke. If I'd taken that step, I probably wouldn't have been able to stop. I would have been on the merry-go-round again, without any desire or strength to get off. That evening I did some praying and self-examination, and decided to call Monique and tell her I was going to get sober. She was thrilled with the prospect, and I promised I would follow through with my decision. In the next few weeks I opted to slowly decrease the dosage of all the junk I was consuming. Finally, by mid-September, I was completely done with everything. I called Jimmy Genter and told him I'd like to hit a few meetings that week. I believe he may have heard through some of our mutual friends that I'd fallen off the wagon. He agreed to join me, and I slowly began regaining my sobriety one day at a time. As of today, I haven't had a drink or any opiates or tranquilizer since September 15, 2006. By the time this book is released, I will have celebrated 5 years of sobriety. Life is full of twists and turns, but there are only two roads you can follow. The choice is up to you. Even though I was working on my new album at the time, I got the itch to hit the road and perform live with my newly formed band. I hired an agent and we quickly put together a U.S. tour. I realized performing sober was lots of fun, and we kept adding dates to our tour schedule. I wanted to prove to everyone else in the business that what Gene Simmons had said about me was a lie. He had basically slandered my name in the press by telling everyone I was still a drunk and a drug addict. Furthermore, he said I was unreliable as an artist, and unemployable. It wasn't the first time this had happened, and I needed to show the world that Gene had his head up his ass. The tour continued in the States and then went through Canada without any mishaps. I appeared at every show and met every contractual obligation that was required of me. I've always been the kind of person who draws strength from adversity, and this was just another example of my resiliency. Later that year we did a sold out show in London at the Hammersmith Odeon and received rave reviews across the board. With the tour under my belt and some positive press to rebut Gene's negative campaign, I decided to go back into the studio and finish my new studio album. Despite the many ups and downs I had with Kiss over the years, I couldn't help but remember all the fun we shared in our formative years. We achieved greatness in the music industry and had several groundbreaking achievements well into the new millennium. To this day, I still consider them my brothers in rock and roll and love them. When I got back to New York, I went into the studio and recorded the rest of the songs for my new studio album. After completion of the overdubs, I set my sights on California and hired Marty Fredrickson to mix and master the CD, with an assist from Anthony Fox. The tracks were sounding great, and while mixing in Burbank, California, I started getting lonely and decided to call up an old acquaintance. I met Rachel Gordon in 2008 while I was appearing at the House of Blues in San Diego. Her good friend Victor, who was a big fan of mine, brought her to the show not knowing what to expect. Upon meeting Rachel, I was immediately intrigued and invited her to come back to my hotel for a visit. When she appeared at my door with a group of friends, I asked her to leave the rest of her entourage outside except for her girlfriend Vanessa. My guitar roadie, Mark, was in the room, and he expressed a desire to meet Rachel's friend. They politely entered my room, and after a few minutes I cornered Rachel and engaged in a conversation to try to get to know her better. While I was talking to her, our eyes locked, and I had a very strange sensation. It felt like I had known her my whole life. But how could I? We'd just met. The only thing I could surmise was that we must have had a relationship with each other in a past life. As we continued talking, the phone rang. It was my road manager. I had a show in Los Angeles the following night, and he informed me that everyone was heading up there now. He suggested I leave as well. I told Rachel I had to split, but not without inviting her to come to L.A. for the weekend. Unfortunately, she declined. "I'm not that kind of girl," she said. We kept in touch sporadically over the next several months, but our schedules wouldn't allow for a reunion until more than a year had passed. In April 2009, Rachel accepted my invitation to join me in Burbank, where I was finishing my new CD. We spent the entire weekend together and formed a solid bond. She returned a few weeks later and we spent another weekend together. Slowly but surely, we fell in love. Rachel was the first woman I'd met who I felt really understood me. She's also taught me how to enjoy life again without the use of alcohol and drugs. I was surprised to discover that Rachel was also a singer. She'd released a few CDs and done some touring, too. With so much in common, our relationship blossomed, and by July we decided to get a place together in Los Angeles. In the fall, she accompanied me on a long European tour. Upon returning to the States, we decided to recuperate in Las Vegas for the holidays. After giving it some thought, we decided to get engaged on New Year's Eve, 2010. We've been together ever since. My latest album, Anomaly, was released on September 15, 2009, to rave reviews, exactly 3 years after I became sober. It debuted at number 27 on the Billboard 200, which was again special. Remember, 27 is my lucky number. But that fall was a time of both celebration and sadness. Shortly before Anomaly was released, I got the call from a friend at Gibson Guitars who informed me that the great Les Paul had passed away. I had met Les many years earlier and thought he was just a delight to be around. I was lucky enough to have had the pleasure of jamming with Les, and I'll never forget that day. Les was always up and positive and never had a bad word for anyone. Sometimes he'd even crack silly jokes. For example, "Ace, you know why I like women with small hands?" "I don't know," I said. "'Cause they make my pecker look bigger." Les was a great human being and a creative genius. He was the inventor of multi-track recording and the electric guitar, and so much more. Sometime later I got another call and was asked if I would make a presentation at the New Jersey Hall of Fame to Lay Paul's son, Russ. The ceremony honored New Jerseyans who had made invaluable contributions to society with a Lifetime Achievement Award. Along with Lay, the honorees included Danny DeVito, Susan Sarandon, and Jack Nicholson, to name a few. I thought it was such an honor to be asked to present the award to Russ Paul, and I quickly accepted. Rachel accompanied me to the ceremony, along with my manager, Dave Frey, and my assistant, John Ostrowski. It was a star-studded event, and I enjoyed every minute of it. I walked out with my Ace Frehley signature series Lay Paul and explained to the audience that it was one of Lay Paul's creations with a little help from me. It was a night to remember. And I know Lay was up in heaven, looking down at us with a big smile on his face. Epilogue, New York City, October 5, 2010. Now here's a curious moment. I'm wandering around backstage at Carnegie Hall, waiting to take my turn at the mic. How improbable is it that I'm here, participating in something called Redemption Song, an event billed as an evening of conversation and performance exploring the relationship between artistry, dependency, recovery, and longevity. How unlikely. How remarkable. Not that I don't belong. Artistry, dependency, recovery, and longevity. I certainly know a few things about the first couple of items on that list. And I'm learning about the third. It's the last one, longevity, that still has me a little stumped. There are times I wake up in the morning and feel like I can easily ponder the inner workings of quantum mechanics, but other mornings I'm lucky if I can find my ass with both hands. Regardless, I toss off the covers, greet the new day with a smile, and get on with the business of life. God knows I'm trying to do it right this time around. I personally believe this: we have only today, yesterday's gone and tomorrow is uncertain. That's why they call it the present. And sobriety really is a gift, for those who are willing to receive it. A few years ago I made an appearance at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame in Cleveland, where they were honoring Lay Paul, shortly before he passed away, with a week-long celebration of his life achievements in the music industry. I had met Henry Juskiewicz, CEO of Gibson USA, about 20 years earlier, and we had become good friends over the years. I got up in front of all these people, talked about my career and my sobriety, and told them about the last time Henry and I had spent any time together. Henry is a very generous guy, I said. He threw a big birthday party for me. I was supposed to be there at 7:30, and I think I showed up around 1 o'clock in the morning. The audience laughed, which was fine, but the memory made me cringe, all those people waiting for me to arrive, but I was just too wasted and kept missing my flights. Henry and my other friends at Gibson had taken the time to organize a birthday party, and I was just oblivious to all their hard work. I apologized publicly that night at the Rock and Roll Hall of Fame. And now that I'm sober, I added, I don't have to worry about things like that happening anymore. I paused. I mean, I'm still late all the time, but at least I'm straight. Everyone laughed again, then burst into applause. It felt good to get that off my chest, since I'd been holding it inside for years. I still work on my sobriety and attend meetings when I can. I need to remember what I used to be like, and how lousy I felt both physically and mentally toward the end. How irresponsible I was, and how it affected my co-workers and loved ones. I believe all the mistakes and dangerous detours were things I needed to go through to get where I am today. I draw strength from the pain I went through, and only now am I beginning to realize it was part of a much larger plan that is continually unfolding, every day. I'm very thankful I was given a second chance at life. Today I enjoy performing live, writing, and recording, and traveling more than ever before. I feel like my eyes have been opened. After attending Bill Aucoin's funeral last year in Florida, Rachel and I decided to go on a road trip and drive cross-country back to Los Angeles. Even though I'd been to most of the places we visited while on tour with Kiss and the Ace Frehley band, I saw everything in a different light, and made discoveries that totally blew my mind. Visiting Monument Valley and Mount Rushmore made me feel like I was 10 years old again. Now we're planning a trip to visit the pyramids at Giza. Which brings us back to Redemption Song and Carnegie Hall, and a night I never could have imagined. My sponsor, Jimmy, also is in attendance, offering a little monologue about the night we met following my wrong way trip through White Plains back in 83, and the unlikely friendship that arose from that encounter. The story is by way of introduction. That's the format for the evening: a little talking, and a lot of music, performed by an eclectic group of artists: Ricky Lee Jones, Guns N' Roses drummer Steven Adler, Run DMC frontman Daryl McDaniels, and me. We're very different people, of course, with different backgrounds, different tastes in music, and different points of view on any number of subjects. Our commonality, our bond, is that we all are addicts. But we're musicians, too, and now it is my turn to play the part. The crowd applauds warmly as I take a seat on the stage, guitar in hand. There are only two of us out here, me and my buddy Eddie Ojeda, from Twisted Sister, also on guitar. I start to tune up a little, when suddenly it dawns on me, this is the first time I performed this song live, with just acoustic guitars. We're gonna need your help on this, I tell the audience. Because we don't have a drummer. Everyone laughs. It's a friendly room, that's for sure. Suddenly the laughter melts into applause as Steven Adler appears to my right. What am I? He blurts out. Chopped liver. I give Steven a little nod, then slowly begin to tap my foot. Eddie does the same. The tapping grows louder as Steven takes up the cue and stomps about the stage, pumping his fists in time, and finally putting his hands together. The audience joins in, and soon the entire room is rocking. I look over at Eddie and smile, and together we begin to play. I can't remember how many times I performed this song in my hometown, but that night seems magically different. I'm overcome with emotion and my eyes begin to water as I glance around the entire room. I start singing the first verse, and the energy in the air becomes electric. As I approach the chorus, I am filled with a new sense of accomplishment and pride in the message, which, as always, is open to interpretation. Here I am, again in this city, with a fistful of dollars, and you'd better believe I'm back. Back in the New York groove. And a California suntan doesn't suck. Awk.